of Zeppelins. Today is even the first time I'm hearing of the word. In my church, what we normally do in preparation for Easter is normally we do crusades, and before the Easter holidays comes, we do fast and other prayer activities.
I do observe Lent. Lent is a 40-day fast that is observed by Christians in honor of our Lord Jesus Christ when he did his 40-day fast. What I'm doing this period of Lent, in observation of the Lent, is that I'm taking myself away from other loves, other things like spending time with friends and going out, watching TV and all that, to spend time with God, to pray, to read the word, to go to church. We have a lot of church services in the evenings to observe this period.
I have never heard of Lent. Before Easter, we pray for everyone in the church.
No, I don't. I don't observe Lent. It's a, how do you call it? A Christian observation, which begins on Ash Wednesday, and then it ends some weeks, I think about 5 or 6 weeks before Easter.
I haven't even heard about Lent before. It's only today I came to hear something that is called Lent. And actually in our church, from March, drawing close to April, we fast in 7 days. We call it revival.
I observe Lent. I understand Lent as a season of reflection and preparation towards Easter. This season of Lent, I'm trying to go for Mass every day. And I'm not fasting entirely from food, but kind of reducing what I eat. And also try as much as possible to be kind to other people consciously, because sometimes you have to consciously try to be kind to people.
Lent is a season for Christians where we celebrate Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. So for us, Christians, it's a time that we devote for prayer, meditation, and introspection. We look at what we have done and what Christ has done for us.
Lent is a solemn religious observance in the Christian liturgical calendar. Lord Jesus Christ did for us on the cross. It's a time for repentance. When I say repentance, not just being sorry for what you have done, but turning away from what you say you were sorry about. And I would say that Lent is also to listen to what God has for you and not what you want to do for yourself.
As Catholics, we follow Christ according to various seasons. For instance, we have the season of Advent, we have the season of Christmas, we have the season of Lent, we have the ordinary times. These are various seasons within the liturgical year, within the church. Then during each season, we celebrate various mysteries of Christ's life for us as followers of Christ. Lent is that moment of prayer, fasting, penance, and reconciliation. It is simply a moment of preparation towards the celebration of the Paschal mystery of Christ. Our faith is centered on this resurrection of Christ. That is why we need an intense preparation towards celebrating this feast. When we go to first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians, chapter 15, verse 14, it says, if Christ had not risen from the dead, our proclamation of the gospel is in vain. Our faith itself is in vain. So our faith depends on the resurrection of Christ. And to celebrate this great feast in a worthy manner or worthily, then we need a period of preparation. Lent for us Catholics is that moment of preparation.
We would trace Lent from our church fathers, who also drew from the Bible. A period of preparation and fasting likely to be observed before the Easter festivities since the apostolic times. Though the practice was not formalized until the first council in Nicaea in 325 EC, it was a time for preparation of candidates for baptism and a time of penance for grievous sinners who were excluded from communion and were being prepared to be restored back into the church. As a sign of repentance, they wore sackcloth and then they sprinkled ash on themselves. This is a public thing that is done.
Before Easter was known as the period of Lent, which is characterized by various spiritual exercises, especially of prayer and fasting.
The season of Lent was kept as a special devotion of self-denial, humble repentance, born of a faithful heart that uses the Word of God as our only hope. Christians around the world set aside the 6 weeks prior to Easter as a time for preparation for Lent.
It is a time for fasting. Those who have underlying conditions, pregnant women, the sick, the weak, the aged, may be exempted or do partial fasts like 6 to 9 or 6 to 12. But the most important thing is that you are in the presence of God, asking for forgiveness and drawing close to God.
St. Paul will tell us that we are soldiers of Christ. And as soldiers of Christ, we need to fight constantly spiritual battles. And as Christians, we see the moment that we spent during Lenten season as moment of battlefield for us to fight the temptations of this world so that we could overcome them. Because a soldier does not entangle himself with worldly affairs. So during Lenten period, you are able to empty yourself. You leave everything aside to focus and to concentrate on Christ. But more importantly, for people who celebrate the moment of Lent is the people we call catechumens, people who are being prepared to receive baptism at Easter. So during this moment, they are led through various stages so that they'll be able to discover Christ and accept the word of God in their life. And at the end of the season, they are baptized and they are received officially into the church and they are given Holy Communion.
The season for the Lent is 40 days. Lent is 40 days. There are 46 days beginning Ash Wednesday to Easter. But during Lent, we take away the Sundays. So it's basically Monday to Saturday. So when you count, you get 40 days. 40 days because we replicate the account of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ's journey in the desert. Not only Jesus, but when you read Exodus 24:18 through 25, you see that Moses also fasted for 40 days in the presence of God, listening to God.
So the period of 40 days is very symbolic. 40 days is very symbolic. It has a spiritual significance to all Christians. For instance, when you go deep into the Bible, you see that Moses climbed to Mount Sinai to receive the Ten Commandments, and he stayed there for 40 days and 40 nights without eating any food or drinking any water. That's in Exodus chapter 34, verse 28. Then we have an example of the prophet Elijah, who walked for 40 days and 40 nights to the mountain of the Lord. that is Mount Horeb, also known as Mount Sinai. 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 8. So you see that in the Old Testament, the number 40 has a very important significance to the Christians. Then we have the example of Jesus himself, who was in the desert for 40 days, where he prayed and fasted before his public ministry. So the number 40 comes from these examples that are in the Bible, and Christians try to imitate this number of days in their preparation towards Easter. 40 days that you empty yourself, you pray, you fast, and you encounter the glory of the Lord. In the Catholic Church, we see Sunday as a celebration of Easter, a resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. So on the same day, we celebrate that joyful nature that Christ rose from the dead triumphantly. So it's not a day of mourning, it is not a day for fasting, and it is not a day that will be sad and within ourselves. It's a joyful day. That is why during the period of Lent, we do not count Sundays in the days of fasting. So the days of fasting are from Monday to Saturday. And we celebrate Sunday as a joyful day because Christ resurrected on that day.
Ash Wednesday is the beginning of Lent. It is a solemn reminder of human mortality and the need for us to reconcile to God. So God expects us to be reconciled to him. When you read 2 Corinthians 5 from 17 through to 21, God wants us to reconcile to him. So Ash Wednesday, we remind ourselves that we are dust. Remind ourselves that we are mortal beings and we need to be reconciled to God. You see people going around with ash on their foreheads. Where is this ash coming from? The palm fronds we use on Palm Sunday is kept, prayed over, preserved, and then is burnt. That is what we use for Ash Wednesday. Instead of sprinkling it on the people, you mark the foreheads of the people to signify that you are mortal. We put on the ash also to signify repentance, brokenness, and death. In the Methodist Church, when the reverend minister, the pastor, is applying the ash or imposing the ash on the foreheads of members, this is the prayer that is prayed. Remember that you are dust. You came from dust, and to dust you shall return. And this is biblical. When God was telling Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, God said, you are dust, and to dust you shall return.
So when you go to the book of Job, Job was able to lie down in the ashes so that to show that I am empty before the Lord. I am dust. And we heard of the story of the Nineveh. The Ninevites, when Jonah preached to them, they were able to lie down in ashes, put sackcloth, and they fasted and prayed for 40 days. So these examples in the Bible also inspire us to imitate that journey of emptying ourselves, putting the ashes as signs of penance and repentance before the Lord.
Yeah, during the season of Lent, we have time for fasting, a time for abstinence, a time for prayer, and a time for sharing, giving of alms.
It is not to say that you stop work and then stay home for 40 days to do the fasting. But you have the mind that you are fasting. You read the word of God more. You draw closer to God more through prayer and through the reading of the Bible. The fasting basically is from food. We fast from food. One is expected to have one meal a day. Those with underlying conditions and the aged and the weak can do that, abstain from food till a certain time in the day. And then we abstain from sex as married couples. We abstain from TV. You see, anything that is rightfully yours that you enjoy, that brings you comfort, you stay away from it, and then you use the time to draw closer to God through prayer, reading of the word, and then, yes, meditating on the word.
During the season of Lent, all Christians are called to follow Christ in a more intimate way through prayer, fasting, and almsgiving. These are the three pillars of Lent. During this period, all Catholics are called upon or are invited to imitate Christ in a more intimate manner. And the three pillars of prayer and fasting characterizes our Christian journey with the Lord. Prayer, fasting, where you'll be able to deny yourself of all bodily pleasures that we have. You are able to empty yourself before the Lord to know that you are thirsty for the Lord. You are hungry for the Lord. You want to follow the Lord. And during that moment, you'll be able to also reach out to your neighbor, because the Christian journey is a journey of communion. We are not isolated. You cannot walk alone. You walk with the other. So during the Lenten season, your eyes are opened more closely to the person who is in need beside you. So when you empty yourself, you don't gather these things into a barn, just like that rich man who said that I've gathered enough for myself, I can eat and drink, no. But you do this with the intention to reach out purposely to that person who is suffering and who is in need. Then that is where the almsgiving becomes very important spiritual exercise for all of us. During Lent, we need to dispose ourselves totally to Christ. There is a kind of a Christian dignity that we need to put on ourselves. A Christian dignity means that we will be able to focus intently on our Christian vocation and calling. We do not live like people of the world. We live like people who are ready for judgment. We live like people who are going to encounter Christ, the bridegroom. So we need to adopt that Christian attitude of dignity, repentance, and conversion. We are all sinners before the Lord. No one is righteous before the Lord. Therefore, when you come to that moment of realization, and you know that you are guilty before the Lord, you need to confess your sins, you need to repent, and you need to turn to the Lord. And that is the moment of Lent. That is appropriate, because immediately after Lent, we need to jubilate, we need to celebrate, we need to glorify the Lord, because he has conquered death. It is a moment of celebration. Therefore, to come to that greater height of the celebration, we need to climb a mountain. Just like the mountain of Transfiguration, when the disciples needed to climb up to that mountain to see the glory of Jesus Christ. For us Christians also, the moment of Lent is for us to walk that journey of suffering with Christ by denying ourselves, by intensifying our prayers, so that at the end we'll be able to see that glory of Christ in our life.
Lent is not a time to test your willpower. You might have a goal, yes, but it is not to test that I'll be able to do 40 days of fasting. I'll not be able to do it. It's not a time to test your willpower. So you do as and when, or what your strength can allow you to do. So the most important thing is that it is an opportunity to draw closer to God, not only during 40 days. Okay, 40 days, I am drawing closer to God. And then after 40 days, I go back to my normal lifestyle. No. You draw closer to God. You make some resolutions that after that, I'll be able to do A, B, C. Drawing strength from God, asking God to give me the necessary grace to be able to do this, to be able to do that, to come out of this weakness and so on and so forth.
During this period of Lent, it's a time that we look at Christ as our focus, what he did for us. We don't do anything. It's Christ who has done it. He obeyed God's word. He offered himself to sacrifice for our sin. So it's a period that we observe, having a quiet time, abstaining from food and other things that we think they are obstacles in our way of living.
As Christians, we need to deny ourselves certain pleasures, especially during Lenten season, not to enter into flamboyance. I mean, to live in that kind of joyful mood. It's a solemn moment for us. So during a Lenten season, when you see most of our churches, we use violet. Violet is a sign of solemnity, of preparation towards that encounter of the Lord. So we are simple. We become empty before the Lord, and we'll be able to focus our minds on the Lord. So during Lent, the do's are to intensify prayer, to fast, and to give alms. And the don'ts is not to engage in that kind of lively life. Something should mark us to show that we are in a solemn moment.
Don't use Lent to lose weight, even though you are abstaining from delicacies and things that will bring you comfort. You don't use it to lose weight. You are rather emptying yourself of self, of the flesh, and allowing the Spirit of God to fill you so you can move on as a Christian. And then during Lent, I would say that you don't focus on yourself. Don't focus on yourself. Focus on other people. Most importantly, we are called upon to improve our relationship with God. So you focus on God, focus on others, focus on doing good things for other people, and giving alms, supporting other people, building other people up. Not too much on yourself. Don't dwell too much on yourself. And then one thing is that we tend to be rigid with our intentions during Lent. I won't do this. I won't do that. It is not necessarily about the do's and the don'ts. Don't be rigid. But if you fall along the way, the most important thing is that you rise up, start again, start afresh. The God we serve is not a God who is rigid about things. Remember that we are human beings. We are mortals. So your humanness at a point will come to play. When it comes to play, don't be too hard on yourself. Get up. Move on.
Yeah, for us in our church, we don't make noise. We don't sing loudly. Yeah, everything is done soberly. It's a time. It's a time that we need to meditate and look at our sins, how it costs God for Christ to die for us, the importance of daily repentance. We sin daily. And as Martin Luther said, we need to confess our sins daily. We sin by our thoughts, our deeds, the words that we use, our actions. So we are sinners. We are not perfect. We struggle with temptation. We struggle with sin. That is why we need to confess our sins daily and depend on the merits, what Christ did for us, going to the cross and dying for us. The importance also to focus on the word of God. That's our strength. That's where our strength comes. Although we struggle, but the word continue to strengthen us.
It is my prayer and it is my earnest desire that after 40 days of fasting and prayer, drawing close to God, Christians will come out better people. We will be the light that God expects us to be to the world, and we will be the salt that God expects us to be to this decaying world. So that is my prayer, that as we come out, there will be a change for the better in our lives in this world.
Christ has won us victory. Christ is our master. He has conquered death. And just as the song will tell us on Easter, the death is conquered. For us also to participate in that victory, we need to journey with Christ. And we need to recall and be aware of our sinful nature. We are Christians trying to imitate our Lord Jesus Christ. And we are imitating him so that we can reach salvation. Salvation that will lead us to that eternal joy. Therefore, during this moment, as we are called upon as Christians to make a bit of sacrifice, it shouldn't be a burden upon us. It shouldn't be something that we see as archaic. It shouldn't be a moment for us to say that, oh, it's normal, it's usual for us. Every year it happens. Lent goes beyond the normal. It is an extraordinary moment for us to encounter that live experience of spiritual nourishment. It is a moment that our soul thirsts for the living God. It is a moment that we run to God as our refuge. So this is a moment for us to pray, to offer ourselves totally, especially during this difficult moment that we find ourselves, to pray for the forgiveness of sins of humanity, so that we'll be able to see that beatific vision that Christ has promised to us. We know that Christ is journeying with us, and no matter how hard the battle is for us, we shall have our victory just as Christ had his victory.